to the outer edge of the city of Los Angeles. A scattered collection of shacks, trailers, and weather-beaten bungalows. Flat and impoverished, it is the last place on earth to look for the extraordinary or for the shadow of greatness. The people of the town have long wondered about Simon Rodia. Simon Rodia, tile setter by trade, Italian-born, American for half a century, builder of defiant towers.
Start to move sometimes. You go out there, it starts, it gives you the impression that it's moving, and you can feel the energy of Simon and what he really wanted. He wanted to be on that ship to go back to Sereno and Rivetoli up there in those mountains where he came from. He would love to have gone back to see his family and to be a part of that. But so he built something, you know, out of his imagination, out of his mind, out of his soul. He built something that would take him back if that were possible. Some see the Watchtowers as more important to the United States of America than the Statue of Liberty. She was built by a Frenchman and she was floated in. The Watchtowers were built by one single immigrant, Sabato Rodia. A lot of people think that the Watchtowers were built by a black man. They never noticed what color Simon was. People thought he was a little eccentric and a little crazy, but what the heck, you know, who isn't? But he was a phenomenal man who needed to express himself and needed to feel safe in expressing himself. What he represents is what a little man can do with a desire to build, to do something big. And he did something big. And when he finished, he gave the property and the deed to a neighbor and he walked away. My name is Rosie Lee Hooks. I'm director of the campus, which includes the Watchtowers Art Center, the Charles Mingus Youth Art Center, the Watchtowers. We are the guardian of the Watchtowers and the tour program and museum education. The Watchtowers are 92 years old and we are 52 years old, so we really look at our heritage in a very special kind of way. We're known internationally, but in LA, you know, the only thing you hear about Watts is who got shot and what gang is on doing this, that, and the other. We're kind of pushed in a corner with that kind of image, but we're also continuing to say we are more than that. We are much more than that. We are very rich. Look at what we do. Look at our culture. Look who's associated to us. And once you come here, we've got you.
In 1984, when I first came here, I was really amazed that one man could have that dedication and stamina and vision to build something like that without any technical help, without scaffolding, without power tools. And I was even more amazed that it was done without any drawings, any design, and man whom some would have called uneducated had such an intuitive feeling for engineering and for structures that he built something like that, that actually withstands all the earthquakes that it has endured, the wind, the heat, and so on. It certainly shows damage, but which monument does not after that period of time? The problem with the old repair is that the repair materials could not respond to the movement of the cracks and therefore failed. So we are looking at a material that's used routinely in the cement industry for expansion joint filling. They can expand 100% and be compressed 50%. So they can accommodate quite a bit of movement. The most critical part with them is proper installation. I myself have 40 years of experience in the field of conservation as a scientist and have worked in architectural conservation since the second half of the 70s. I was in charge of the restoration of the tomb of Queen Nefertari, environmental studies on the Great Sphinx in Giza, and similar projects. As far as I'm concerned, the watchtowers is probably the most difficult project of my career. In the beginning, I don't even have a notepad. I have a camera, and that's all I take with me, and a magnifying glass, and maybe binoculars in a site like this. And I just walk the site and try to understand it. I try to understand what may be going on. It's like doing when the doctor does a general physical. He looks at your blood pressure, he looks at this, at that, and the other thing, and then tries to form an image about what is or is not wrong with you. It's similar, you do it with a monument like that. You don't jump into it prematurely. It leads to mistakes. It's a multifaceted treatment we are now developing. We want to treat it respectfully as a work of art, but at the same time, it is a piece of architecture for which we have a certain way of dealing with architecture. And there are things we can do to architecture that we cannot do to art. Being a big outdoor monument, we cannot deal with it like with a museum object. And for museum objects, we have our own ways of dealing with and our own ethics. We have to find not only technical solutions, which is challenging in itself, we have to find that middle way between architecture and work of art in how we treat it. Because we not only want our repairs to last long, we also want them to look good. So we have to do things that we would not do to an artwork, simply to assure the safety of the monument for humans visiting it. And that makes it very complicated. The way they are constructed, when you look at it, they have an interior steel element. And then this is wrapped with wire mesh. Then Rodia put on top of it a cement mortar, cement plaster. And while the cement was still wet, he embedded the decorative elements, which in this case are tiles. It can be ceramics, it can be seashells, it can be glass, bottle glass, window glass, security glass, you find everything. Found objects, broken objects. He pilfered the steel wherever he could get it. Where he did not do shortcuts was the cement. Rodia, in terms of his cement, was very consistent. People ask him, why don't you hire somebody or get somebody in? And quality control, according to his comment, was they don't know how to handle it. So he was very proud of his ability. The problem he faced, however, is as the towers grew taller, he was mixing the cement in a steel bucket and he was carrying it on his shoulder. And as he was climbing up, the cement was drying out. Now, while Rodia still was working, he was doing restoration. So he had cracks forming, he had problems, and he restored completed parts of the towers while he was still building in other parts. The towers are structurally stable. We are working with engineers and have verified that. But in the long run, if nothing is done about them, they may actually ultimately jeopardize the stability of the towers.
We needed to come up with a viable way of taking care of the towers, but that decreased our dependency on the general fund. In recent years, we've been working with the Los Angeles County Museum of Art to preserve the towers, to get a better understanding of just what the scientific principles are behind repairing the towers, curatorial knowledge, conservation knowledge. So this has been just a real strategic alliance of two institutions that have come together not only to preserve the towers, but to market them more effectively, encourage other people to come here.
LACMA is actually in a good position to undertake a project like this because it has a scientific laboratory dedicated to the study of deterioration and restoration of works of art. We have a whole slate of analytical equipment and of testing equipment like X-radiography, infrared reflectometry, and so on, that allows us to analyze materials, test their performance, etc. One major concern is we are constantly losing decorative elements. The problem is that the cement and the ornaments heat up differentially. The cement gets hotter than the glass and the ceramic. So the first task we had was to determine why did the past repairs not work. And in the past, people worked from one assumption, and that is that the cracks are caused by the interior steel corroding. And we know that from commercial buildings and residential concrete buildings, that corroding steel expands and can cause cement to crack. But other studies have proposed other causes for the crack formation. First of all, the towers are heavy. The heaviest towers is 32,000 pounds. And the towers are flexible, they are moving. Being in Los Angeles, every spring we have Santa Ana season, where we have these strong winds coming from the north. The acceleration is from the wind event on the towers is equivalent to a moderate earthquake. And as you walk around, you see the same phenomenon over and over again. Like here, you see multiple repairs of the same crack. And there's an old saying, namely that a building or a structure develops cracks where it needs them. So the simplest way of determining if a crack is active and changing dimensions actively or not is to put a plaster bridge over it. And this bridge here actually broke within a week or two. So we installed crack monitors, we installed thermocouples. What we found is that there's a daily movement. As the sun comes up and the surface heats up, the cracks are closing. And as the sun goes down and the surface cools down, the cracks are opening. Even worse, the whole towers move. As the sun comes up, they start bending away from the sun. And then as the sun moves around, they bend always away from the sun. And then as the sun goes down, they go back to their original position. So our task basically now is to find repairs that can withstand the thermal movement, the wind-caused movement, and the movement caused by minor earthquakes or moderate earthquakes. The second task is to keep the water away from the steel. So we have to close the cracks so that water cannot go through. And there are also hairline cracks, which we have to treat. My stated goal is that I want to have a treatment that does not require major interventions more frequently than every 20 years. If that is done, then I see no reason why in 100 years or 150 years the tower should not still stand proud there, short of the 10.0 earthquake or whatever that is out of our control. Whenever there are people out there who love something, it's worth preserving. We can interpret a lot of things into a monument, but to me it certainly looks like a three-mast ship, especially with a connection between the East Tower and the Center Tower that looks like some sort of rigging I think he must have been nuts. I don't know how you can spend every 3 minutes for over 30 years, for 34 years, building that thing. But at the same time, all the great ones had some problems. But I admire what he was able to accomplish. I would never have the staying power to do that.
The towers mean to me, personally, survival. It means strength. It means creativity. It means bringing together people who would not normally be together. I think our community is very proud of the watchtowers, also because we are the heartbeat of Watts. You can, if you just be real still for a moment, you can feel that heartbeat. Boom, 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 boom. You feel it?
Thank you.